Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Bethlehem Lutheran Church. Unlike many parts of the nation, we are grateful to see the COVID infections dropping in our area. Schools and the restaurants are once again opening, at least at some level. We're also seeing things cautiously reopening in our church communities. Here at Bethlehem, our quarters are back on Wednesday mornings. Our council will be having a hybrid meeting this Wednesday evening, with some present, some online. At the council meeting on Wednesday, I am hoping we will vote to resume in-person worship on January 17th. All this, of course, depends on what happens over the next few days. The key to keeping our schools, churches, businesses open is maintaining the social distancing outside our homes and wearing our masks when we are around others. To the extent that we do that, we'll be able to keep things going and open without many people getting sick. So please, for the sake of our kids, our businesses, our churches, and those most vulnerable about us, let us do our part. The council did meet this week for an open discussion with United Lutheran and Lay Podium. Conversations are ongoing, and we will let you know when we have anything concrete to announce. But I must say, it was an encouraging discussion. Remember, later during the service, we'll be celebrating communion, so if you haven't had a chance to turn up the volume now, and sneak out the kitchen to find some bread and wine. Just a reminder, we have prepackaged communion kits that you can pick up at the church on Monday morning and Saturday afternoon. Before we begin, while Minnesota has spared the worst of the COVID wave, we're seeing daily records being broken in COVID hospitalizations and deaths across the nation. So please keep our whole nation in your prayers. Also, we want to lift up our nation in the aftermath of this past Wednesday. Words have power, power to calm and power to incite. May God grant that those in power recognize that politics is not a game, but a high calling to work for the good of all people. With that in mind, hear the words of our Lord Jesus. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your Father in heaven is perfect. Let us pray. O God, when hearts are fearful and constricted, grant us courage and hope. Where anxiety is infectious and widening, grant peace and reassurance. Where impossibilities close every door and window, grant imagination and resistance. Where distress twists our thinking, grant healing and illumination. Where spirits are daunted and weakened, grant soaring wings and strengthened dreams. All these things we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. Today's service is a fun one based on the liturgy put to the tune of favorite hymns. This is something Luther enjoyed doing from time to time. So we will have some fun with it today. Before we turn to that, though, please stand and join me for the brief order for confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out on all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin, trusting in the abundant grace of God. O Holy God, you search us and know us. You are acquainted with all our ways. We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin, our own sins, and the broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust those who are not like us. We exploit the earth and its resources, and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone. Even before the words are on our tongues, you know them. Receive them in your divine mercy. Amen. How vast is God's grace. Through the power and promise of Christ Jesus, our sins are washed away. And we are claimed as God's own beloved. Indeed, we are forgiven. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community, living out Christ's justice and the Spirit's reconciling peace.
Amen.
Spirit of gentleness, verses 1 and 2. Find it on page 203. join me in the prayer of the day. Holy God, creator of light
and giver of goodness,
your voice moves over the waters.
Immerse us in your grace
and transform us by your Spirit,
that we may follow after your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord,
who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit,
one God, now and forever.
Amen. Please be seated for the reading of the lessons.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Our first reading comes from Genesis, first chapter. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm today is Psalm 29, please read. Ascribe to the Lord, you gods. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Ascribe to the Lord the glory due God's name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness.
The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord is upon the mighty waters.
The voice of the Lord is a powerful voice. The voice of the Lord is a voice of splendor.
The voice of the Lord breaks the cedar trees. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon.
The Lord makes Lebanon skip like a calf, and the mountain Hermon like a young wild ox.
The voice of the Lord bursts forth in lightning flashes.
The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh.
The voice of the Lord makes the oak trees bright and strips the forest bare. And in the temple of the Lord, all are crying, glory.
The Lord sits enthroned above the flood. The Lord sits enthroned as King forevermore.
O Lord, give strength to your people. Give them, O Lord, the blessings of peace. Our second reading is the 19th chapter of Acts. While Apollos was in Corinth, Paul passed through the interior regions and came to Ephesus, where he found some disciples. He said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you became believers?" They replied, "No, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." Then he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" They answered, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one who was to come after him, that is, in Jesus." On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. Altogether, there were about 12 of them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the peoples of Jerusalem were going out to John and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came up from Nazareth to Galilee and was baptized by John in the river Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
And now our men all sing Wings of a Dove. While the grown-ups enjoyed their coffee after the meal, the four children went out to play. It was a noisy sort of fun, you know, the kind all children enjoy. But then suddenly, there was only silence. Usually not good news. So the parents, wondering what was up now, set out in search. Eventually, they found the kids up behind the barn, playing church. Little Susan was conducting a baptism service. She held a cat up over the rain barrel at the corner of the barn. And Solomon said, as her father would say so often in church, "I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and in the Holy Ghost." In the hole, you go. I imagine the cat was not impressed with its rain barrel bath, but little Susan's heart was most certainly in the right place. And to be honest, one can confuse her about her confusion about the Holy Spirit. After all, she had good company. The believer St. Paul found in Ephesus didn't quite have it right either. They didn't even know about the Holy Spirit. So Paul was faced with a question many of us are faced with today. How do we deal with people like little Susan or like the grown-ups in Ephesus who really don't understand what faith is all about? That is a vital question, because while nominally, at least in name, most people in our society are Christian, but many really don't know what faith is all about. I run into this all the time when I'm asked to do funerals, weddings, and baptisms by those outside the church. I run into it when those without a church home tell me they really don't need to worship God because they basically live a good life, seemingly oblivious to the heart of the gospel, which is that we don't earn our way into heaven. We are not justified by basically living a good life. We are justified by faith, apart from our good works. So how does one deal with folk like these? Well, the obvious answer is we start where people are at. Sometimes the truth is we as Christians just don't know what we believe. Take little Susan, for example. When her ears heard her father say, "And in the name of the Holy Ghost," what her brain translated that was, "In the Holy Ghost." Which makes for a funny story and an easy thing to correct. Some things, though, are not so easy. Unlike the people in Ephesus who were eager and ready to learn, who really wanted to get close to God, there are those around us who are quite content with the status quo. They have their religion of self-fulfillment, goods, and comfort, and they are happy with it. So, should we live and let live, saying, "You go your way, I'll go mine"? Well, that depends. It depends on whether or not you are a Christian. For Christians know that what we believe and where we place our trust matters. And that is why we don't have the luxury of saying, "You do your thing and I'll do mine." We can offer false comfort to those who are on the road to hell. At the same time, though, I don't think God wants us running around crying, "Heretic, heathen." upon encountering such people. For in many, if not most cases, they are not enemies of the faith. Instead, we should follow the lead of St. Paul and bring them to an adequate knowledge and experience of faith. You know, discipleship can have a faulty start. But we should not conclude that a poor start means a bad end. Sound witness, Christian education, brings sound knowledge and a living encounter with our risen Lord. The truth is, in most cases, people don't know any better. As Jesus said, even believers sometimes are like sheep without a shepherd, wandering around. Yet it was for these sheep he came. It was for these sheep he was born, he was baptized, he served, and he died. It was for these and all of us that he rose again. So how dare we give up on anyone? How dare we say, live and let die? Do you have friends? Do you have family? Without a church home? Do you have friends? Do you have family whose religion is a religion of self-fulfillment, goods, and comfort? Of course you do. We all do. We may even have been one of them not that long ago. But now we're going into truth, and that truth calls us out of complacency. It demands that we get involved and take the initiative. Just as our Lord left heaven's comforts and glory to reach out to a broken world, we need to leave the comfort zone of our private faith to reach out into the public world. Jesus didn't have to become one of us. He didn't have to face the messiness of life. If by his birth and by his baptism, that is exactly what he did. Jesus was baptized in order to identify fully with humanity. And humanity he shared completely, even to the point of taking on himself the consequences of our sins. That was a measure of his love for us. And this is the sort of love which must now define who we are. As baptized children of God, we are called raise up our children, our godchildren, our grandchildren in the faith, to share the faith with them and help them understand what it really means. As baptized children of God, we are called to share the faith with others in love. That's our calling. And that is our commitment. And today I invite you to reaffirm that commitment. For those of you who are parents, remember the vows you made when your children were baptized. And recommit yourselves to their fulfillment. By the way, those vows don't stop when they turn 18. For those of you whose friends and family are living without the faith, remember the vows you made when you were confirmed. And recommit yourself to let your light so shine before others that those who see your good works will glorify our Father in heaven. Those good works include sharing real faith for real life, which, by the way, is the title of a small group I would like to lead in person and online. It's about knowing faith well enough to share it and apply it to real life. That's a vital need for our church at this point in its walk. And I don't see any way we can move forward without it. It's time to take our faith out of the closet and live it in the real world. Faith is not a private affair. So while Live and Let Die is a catchy title for a James Bond movie, it does not work for us. Nor does model Live and Let Live. We care too much. We love too much. Do that. So by the grace of God and the power of the Holy Spirit, let your light so shine. Share the faith. Live it. Let others feel its warmth so that they may know the peace of God, which passes all understanding through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. A small change in the order today. We're going to be singing again Spirit of Gentleness, hymn number 396, verses 3 and 4.
Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead.
On the third day he rose again.
He ascended to heaven.
He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins,
the resurrection of the body,
and the life everlasting. Amen.
Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. And to our regular list, we want to add the family of David Perkler. In our prayers, he passed away this past week. for the church throughout the world and its leaders, that guided by the Holy Spirit, they proclaim the forgiveness of sins. Let us pray. Have mercy with us, Lord. For wilderness and water, wind and wild beasts, for all living things on earth, that God's goodness is revealed through creation and faithful stewards care for all God has made. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For the nations of the world and their leaders, for laborers busy both day and night, and for peacemakers amid strife, that God inspire all people to use their strength wisely. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For the sick and those who provide medical care, for the imprisoned and those who show them mercy, for the lonely and those who provide compassion, for those battling COVID and those who care for them, and for all others who are suffering in body, mind, or spirit, especially John, Trevor, Lynn, Randy, Jim, Wayne, Brad, Alice, and Joan, Josie, and John, Karen, Frankie, and Nikki. That the Holy Spirit may move among us and bring healing to them. Lord, in your mercy.
Have mercy, O God.
Lord, we pray for the family of Dale, who passed away this past week. Comfort them with a sure and certain mercy, the sure and certain hope that is ours through Christ Jesus. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
Lord, for congregations and students returning to in-person worship in school, for those seeking renewal of businesses and in their daily work, that all the beloved of God experience grace and mercy. Show us how to support one another in these challenging times. Have mercy on us, God. Have mercy. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
O God, receive these gifts as you receive us. Like a mother receives her children with arms open wide, nourish us anew in your tender care. Empower us in faithful service to tend to others with the same love. Through Jesus Christ, our saving grace.
Amen.
As we prepare for communion, we sing hymn 471.
Lord, you're with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should all times and all places offer thanks and praise to you, Holy God. For in the waters of baptism, you have made us your own. Through the bread and the wine, you forgive our sins. So, in thanksgiving for all this and so much more, we join with angels and archangels, with saints of the present and saints of the past, and join their unending hymn. Same manner also after supper he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave for all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. Take and drink. Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and preserve you unto eternal life. Amen. Let's pray the prayer of our Jesus Christ. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory,
forever and ever.
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace.
Amen. Amen.
The last hymn is number 314. Arise, your light has come.
Good tidings to the
us rejoice in your kindness. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Enjoy the beautiful days coming up this week, folks. God bless you. Have a good day. Goodbye.
God bless. Have a great day.